Blood and Honor. The Hitler Youth initiation ceremony took place in a massive electrical power plant just outside the city. One wall was filled with switches and dials and little gauges with moving needles. Another was covered with Nazi flags and red, white, and black bunting, over which hung a banner that read, "We were born to die for Germany." Huge turtle-like generator housings stood in the background like giant sentinels, electrical gods there to watch our induction into the Olympic pantheon. They thrummed with a frantic, hidden energy. The whole place held a sense of power, of modernity, of the future, which I guess is why they held the ceremony there in the first place. The youth were all those things to Nazi Germany. Its strength, its break from the past, its hope for the future. Even I was impressed. I made a mental note of its location so the Allies could bomb it. An adult Hitler Youth leader, the first one I'd seen all day, stood on a raised metal walkway. Teenagers like Horst ran the smaller troop meetings, but adults from the Hitler Youth Administration showed up for bigger missions and medal ceremonies like this one. We listened while he gave a short, boring speech, and then each of us who passed the initiation test was called forward to take the Hitler Youth Oath. With a last name starting with O, I came in the middle. The Hitler Youth leader told me to put my hand on a folded flag. The flag was called the Blood Banner. Legend had it, this banner had been dipped in the blood of the Hitler Youth's greatest martyr, Herbert Quex Norkus, who had been killed by a gang of communist boys back in the days before the Nazis ruled the whole country. I didn't believe it. That Herbert Norkus had been killed, I believed. But I couldn't believe his blood was really on this flag. We were just one small unit of Hitler Youth boys in Berlin. There were hundreds more groups in the city and thousands more in the rest of the country. If every one of the hundreds of blood banners used to initiate new Hitler Youth members all over Nazi Germany had been dipped in the blood of Herbert Norkus, they must have wrung the poor guy out like a sponge before they buried him. When every last one of us had touched the blood banner and recited the oath, the Hitler Youth leader smiled down on us. "In completing this test, you have fulfilled but a small part of your duty to the fatherland," he told us. "You do so with pleasure, for millions of your young comrades do the same. You have become a soldier for Adolf Hitler." He set the needle on a gramophone recording of a trumpet fanfare, and then we sang a couple Nazi songs. The last one ended with the words, "Today Germany listens to us, and tomorrow the whole world." But the boys changed the lyrics, as they always did, to "Today Germany belongs to us, and tomorrow the whole world." I got a cold shiver, and it wasn't just from my dunk in the pool. If Hitler ever conquered the world, this was how he was going to do it, by turning all of Germany's youth into his willing soldiers. At last, we were all given the thing we had coveted most, the Hitler Youth Dagger. We would wear it in a metal sheath on our belt from now on, wherever we went. It was a symbol, a badge of honor, they said that we had made the cut. The room rang with a collective shing as every one of us pulled our daggers from their sheaths at the same time to marvel at them. The handle was black, decorated with a red and white checkerboard diamond with a swastika in the middle. A finger guard curled over one side of the hilt. The blade itself was only 6 inches long, but it was an inch wide, and engraved on it were the words Blut und Ehr, blood and honor. "Live faithfully, fight bravely, and die laughing, for you are now officially Hitler Youth." The boys cheered, and I raised my fist and pretended to be happy. Nobody cared. As soon as the cheer ended, everyone stampeded over to the bulletin board. It was time to learn which Hitler Youth sections we had been assigned to.